takes. I think many times I've heard a pastor friend of mine said that he used to believe this way. He said that God said it, I believe it, it's done. And he said, how mistaken was I? He said, God don't need me to believe it.
It's already done.
It's already done.
That's right. Yeah.
So now it is, God said it, it's done.
So, yeah.
It's no discussions asked, no questions about it. It's here and here. We just need to learn to take ourselves out of the equation. Because many times, how many of us know that we make it all about us?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. Because no one else is going through anything else except us. Nobody's been through anything else except us. Not realizing that there are thousands and millions of people throughout this whole world that are going through the exact same thing that we've been through. But we make it all about us. So we need to have that mindset change that says God said it, it's done. Whether you want to believe it or not, it's already done. Amen?
Amen.
Because you think about it, back in Genesis, when God says, let there be light, he didn't need us to stand in the gap and go, okay, God, you said it, I'm going to believe it, now there's going to be light.
Yeah.
Mm-mm. God said it, it happened. God spoke it, it happens. So we need to take ourselves out of that equation thinking that we need to remind God about his word, and it's not. We need to remind ourselves about God's word to where we continue to stand on those promises by faith, believing that it's done. Amen? But how many of us know that it's hard to stand on the promises of God when we don't know the promises of God?
That's right.
Yeah, that's right.
And how do we not know it? Because we're not seeking God himself. It's easy to seek the things of God versus God himself. It's easier to say, God, I'm a needy child. I am a spoiled, needy child, and I want. I want, I want, I want. I deserve it. Because you created me, I deserve it. But that ain't the way it works. You can't know the promises of God unless you know God himself. You can remember the scriptures thereof. How many of us remember the scripture of John 3:16? Those are some of the ones that we learned when we was growing up, right? And you got those little ribbons and points and all for all the little scriptures. You remember you got during DBS and stuff? Yeah, Sunday school and all. I remember when I was growing up that we used to come, the kids, they would have us march in and bring in the sheaves. And I thought it meant bringing in the sheep. They used to sing that old song called When the Roll Is Called Up Yonder. I used to think it was When the Roll Is Called a Piano. I don't know where I was going with all that. But I knew it sounded good in here, okay? And I would come marching through them, boy, and I was just the proud, bringing in the sheaves, you know. Boy, I was getting with it, you know. But, you know, we can recite the verses. We can remember where they are. But if we're not applying them to our life, they are just scripture. If we're not living them, then it's nothing but words in a book. It must become part of our lifestyle in order for it to become effective word of God. Come on now. You have your Bibles, turn with me over to Exodus chapter 32, or 33. Exodus chapter 33. you there, say amen.
Amen.
Need me to wait, say wait. If you're looking at the screen, say I got you. That's what I thought. That's all right. Verse 12, it says that Moses said unto the Lord, see, thou sayest unto me, bring me up this people, and thou hast not let me know that whom thou wilt send with me. Yet thou hast said, I know thee by name, and thou hast also found grace in my sight. Now therefore I pray thee, if I have found grace in thy sight, show me now thy way, and I may know thee, that I may find grace in the sight, and consider that this nation is thy people. And he said, my presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest. And he said unto him, if thy presence go not with me, carry us not up hence. Father, I thank you this morning, O Lord. I thank you for your love, your mercy, and your grace, O God. I thank you, Lord, for being in the midst of your people, O Lord. And Father, this morning I ask, God, that, Lord, that we open our ears and our hearts, God, to, Lord, not only hear your word, but, Father, we apply the word. And, Father, once again, Lord, I ask you, Lord, to continue to anoint these old clay lips, Father God, as you continue to hide me behind that cross of Calvary. And I ask this in the name of Jesus, and amen.
Amen.
You see here, Moses is praying for God's presence. He's not praying for God just to do something for him. Many times in our life, that's what we want to do. We'll pray, God, you got to take care of this. And we all know, especially whenever you're driving down that highway and someone is slow poking along, or either they're cutting you off, you go like, Lord, you need to do something with them people. They are driving me crazy. They're going to hurt somebody. Lord, if they're that bad off, they don't need to be driving anyway. Come on now, somebody say amen.
Amen.
You know it. You're praying for God to do something about them, not something for them. I got an amen over here, because I've seen her drive, amen? I know. But here, Moses is seeking God's presence. He's not just seeking a handout. He already, and the word says, Lord, you have already found me favorable. You've already found grace upon me. You've already showed me who you are. You've already instructed me of who you are. But Lord, I need your presence to be with me all the time, every day, every single hour, so that way that I can be guided by you. I want my feet to be ordered by your word, God. I want my voice to be ordered by your word. But the only way that's going to happen is if I can stay in your presence. If your presence goes with me, then I'm okay with it. But if your presence decides to not go, I don't want to go either. I need to stay where you are. I don't need you following me, God. I need to follow you. But the tide turns sometimes, doesn't it? That we want God to follow us. We want God, we drag him around like he's some little object that we can just point at something else and say, okay, I need you to get him. Like he's our great big bodyguard. Mm-hmm. That whenever the enemy, we only call on him when something's not going our way. When something doesn't seem to be going right, that people are not listening to us in the church, come on now, that the Sunday school teacher's not paying, the preacher's always preaching right at me, God, I need you to change that man's heart. I need you to change the message. I'm tired of hearing about this unforgiveness. I'm tired of hearing about the bitterness part about it. God, I'm hearing time talking about my driving. Well, he got cameras on me. God, I need you to change him. Today. See, I got an amen again. We need to be in the presence of God. It's okay to know the scriptures, but if God ain't in it, it's just scriptures. It's just words that we're talking. Let's go back to the disciples, okay? Whenever the young man had a spirit in him, what happened is they showed up out there like they were king of all things. They're like, I got this. Watch me. I've been around Jesus here. I've listened to him talk. I know what he says, and he says this here. So all I got to do is I got to go over and show up and let him know that I've been around Jesus, and this is what's going to happen. They showed up there, and they did all that jibber-jabber that they could. And that spirit sent them running. And they go to Jesus and he says, I don't understand. This is Rick's version, it's not in the King James, I promise you, okay? Jesus, I don't understand why it did not work for me when it worked for you. I don't understand why when I walked up there, that they knew that I had been around you, but it didn't recognize me for some reason. I yelled at it, I spit on it, I kicked it, I slapped it around, I cried over it. Nothing. But Jesus said, what? Such as these things can only become through prayer and fasting. In other words, these things can only happen if you're staying in the presence of God. If you're staying in the presence and God is with you and God's on the move with you, you can do anything. And you know what the scripture says? I can do all things through Christ Jesus, which strengthens me. I can do all things through Christ Jesus. See, we stop at that all things sometimes. Because we come to church, we get these feel goods, we get those little Holy Ghost goosebumps, and we think we've done something. We think that we have been anointed by God to go out and slap the fire out of sinners all day. Come on now. All I got to do is walk in the midst of them, Sister Karen. I got that little touch today. I got that little feel good. You know, I yelled back a little bit. I screamed it. And all that other stuff. I stomped around there. And I felt good about it. Now I'm going to go out here and I'm going to walk in the midst of these sinners. And they all going to flock to me. And they're going to say, how must I be saved? Yeah. You walk in the midst of them, you hear crickets, and all of a sudden you try to witness somebody, and they tell you something other that you didn't like, and then you want to cry to God, but God, I'm doing what you told me. No, you ain't. You're not staying in the presence of God. You're trying to pretend and act around it on a Sunday morning, but you have to live it 24/7. You cannot come to church and act like a saint of God and walk out them doors and let God just be on the bookshelf, never talking, never interacting. Come on now. The prayer and the fasting, come on, the communicating with God and expect God to honor what he said. That's what we do. We wanted that to happen. We go, well, come on. God, your word tells me, by your stripes, I'm healed. And all of a sudden, God heals us. And then what happens? We drift away. We start wanting to do our own little thing. Well, I don't have time. I don't have time to talk to you, Lord. I'm kind of busy right now. I got these things to do. I got other things to do. Lord, you know I got to work. Come on. You know, and when I get done working, I'm so tired, and I come home, all I want to do is just rest. And, you know, everybody calls, everybody does this, and I never have time for myself. Come on now. I never have time for myself. God gives us enough time in every day to do exactly what He wants us to do, and yet He gives us spare time to enjoy the rest. Come on. Sister Cindy, how long can we read the Bible in a year? How much time a day? 15, 20 minutes a day. There's 24 hours in a day. I'm going to go with teenage year time because they sleep 16 hours. So you mean to tell me you cannot read your word along the day for 10 to 15 minutes? We get lunch, right? Most of us get an hour for lunch, don't we? And what are we doing? I know what we're doing. We check in the fool's book. I want to see what Sister such and such said about such and such, and I got to keep up with this over here. Oh, I only have this for friends and family.
You're right.
Come on. I only got this for friends and family, just so they got your phone number. They know how to call you. Trust me, my kids will call me if I don't answer the text. Oh, I know that. They call. But we'll get on this fool's book, and we'll start looking and scrolling and scrolling, and next thing you know, your lunch hour is gone. You ever done that? Come on now, be honest.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We've got on there and said, I just need to check my email. Email goes to Instagram. Instagram goes to Snapchat. Snapchat goes to fool's book. Come on.
Mm-hmm.
All day long. And then we want to say, well, God, I didn't have enough time in the day to communicate with you.
Yep. You're right.
Our God, who loves us so much, that sent His Son to Calvary on our behalf. He bore, He took, gladly laid down His life. He gave it up for you and me. But yet we don't have enough time in the day to stop and say, thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you, God, for loving me. I want to thank you, God, for helping me. I want to thank you for protecting me. I want to thank you for guiding me, God. I just want to thank you, Lord. We don't have enough time in the day to do that. And He says right here, in verse 14. And He said, my presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest. The reason that we're restless is because we're not in the presence. The reason that we are so bogged down, the reason that we are so bound up, the reason that we can't think straight sometimes is because we're not in the presence. Because His Word says that if we're in His presence, He's going to give us what? Rest. In other words, He's going to give us peace. He's going to give us comfort. He's going to give us that love of sound mind to be able to stand in the midst of the turmoil days and say, I know that my God is with me. I know because I feel His presence. I feel the rest that He's given me. I know that I'm hurt. I know that I feel bad. I know what the doctor says. I know what this one over here says. But I also know what my God says. And He says, if I be still and I know that He is God, if I can trust Him enough, if I can believe that every word that He says, that if I'm in His presence, He's going to give me rest. He's going to give me rest. I don't have to think it. I don't have to talk it. I have to believe it. And by believing it, that means I'm living it. How many of y'all used to go to the fair when you was growing up?
Yeah.
How many of you used to believe that you had to be first in line or they were going to give up all the rides? Come on now. Yeah. You're in church. I know. You're like, man, that's the ride I want to get on. Run it. Get into that front. You didn't want to be the last one in line because you wanted to get on that ride. Did you not? And then how many of you got mad because when you got there, they was about to start the ride and there was no more seats, so you had to wait? Oh, y'all know. God knows. I'm telling you. You got all tore up because somebody took your seat because you didn't get there quick enough. You had to wait in line for the ride to go around this business and stop. And then what happened? You're like, man, come on. Open the gate. Open the gate. Open the gate. Like some of y'all on Black Friday. Come on now. Uh-huh. Open the door. Open the door. And knowing that there's a big pile, it's like, get out of the way. I get one. No one else does. I've seen y'all on Black Friday. I know. Y'all some crazy folks on Black Fridays, I'm telling you. Me and my wife went one time, and I said, I'll never go again. Ain't no way. Them people get serious. You cut line, they don't shoot you. You cut line, they're going to find you in the dumpster around the corner. You're like, no way, they're serious. Like, they're going to sell every toy in that place out. They're going to sell everything there is up. Why do we wait for certain times to do certain things? That's exactly why we treat God. We want to be first in everything. And that means putting God second. And we can't do that. If we're going to be in His presence, we need to make sure that He is the author and the finisher of our faith. In other words, that means that He is the beginning and the end. There is no middle in between. He's either there. He's got it all. But then let's go on down to verse 15. And He said unto him, if thy presence go not with me, carry us not up hence. In other words, He's saying, look, Lord, if you're not moving, don't let us move. Don't let us get involved in none of that stuff. Don't let us go to the left or to the right. But Lord, let us stay in Your presence. Let us go where You go. Let us become what You want us to become. Now, I know for a fact how hard it is to sit in a place and you know, God, I know You ain't in this. And I don't know why You're not releasing me. Come on. Whether it's a job or it's the church. God, I don't understand why You're not releasing me. God, I don't know why You won't. I think I'm just going to go. I think that's what it is. I think, God, You want me to take that first step. We always take that scripture that says, you know what? Step out in faith, right? You take the first step, He's going to do the rest. You better make sure He's ordering that first step to take. Because if not, you're going to be walking on your own. I found that out. Yeah, I did. I had a job one time and I said, no, I don't like it. I prayed about it. God's like, nope, you need to stay. And I'm like, nope. I'm by faith, I'm going to step out, and you're going to follow me. I look back, he's still in there, and I'm way out younger. I'm like, man, missed that one big time. If God ain't in it, we don't need to be a part of it. It's not about us. It's about him. It's all about what he is. It's all about what he's already done. He just wants us to be the instruments to fulfill it along the way. To show the love, the mercy, and the grace. To show the kindness. Do you know that you can speak the truth to somebody and not hurt their feelings? Yeah. I had an old lady in the church one time. She said, "Brother, I pray till they get hurt." Like, mind me never make you mad. Because if they don't feel conviction, it ain't working. Well, what do you call your conviction here, you know? But you can go and love the people. Christ comes to love me. When I do something wrong, it's in love. And I know it. And I feel guilty about it. I feel bad about it. But I don't stay in it. I have to move on. Because if God ain't in it, if God don't tell us to move, we don't move. If God doesn't tell us to go over here, there's many things that we would love to start doing here in this church, but we ain't heard from God to say do it. So we're going to wait. Because we want to be in the presence of God. In order for his word to be effective in our lives, we must be in his presence. Because the word teaches us that where God is, so is his power. So, I want to be in the power zone. Amen? We don't need to be in that no zone area. Kind of like our Titans. Amen? Just had to put that out there, sorry. But Moses prays for God's presence. He doesn't pray for God to do something for him. He prays for the presence. In Acts, when Jesus told him to go and tarry, and he's going to send the comforter, he said, wait. You hold on. It's coming. And those that waited saw what God was talking about because they wanted to be in the presence of God. Upon that, there was quite a few people that understood what it meant about being in the presence of God. Amen? So I challenge us today. Let's quit bartering with God. Let's quit demanding of God, of things for him to do for us. But let's pray that we stay in the presence of God. Let's be like Moses and him. Let's pray for the presence. Let's pray for him to be with us and for us to be with him. Amen? Stand with me this morning. Scripture that I used was in Ecclesiastes chapter 3. It talks about for everything under the heavens, there's a season. There's There's a time to cry and a time to laugh, time to mourn and a time to dance. There's a time for everything under the heavens. There's a season for it. And I believe we're in a season now that we need to seek God more than anything. We need to be God-seeking.